دكتور أيمن.
رهاب بعد إذنك، what is the advantage of radio frequency ablation of such perforators over the foam sclerotherapy? Foam sclerotherapy is simple, cheap procedure instead of radio frequency.
I know that Professor Ayman Salem and the group starting working on the perforator using the foam. I agree it is more cheaper, but we don't have long-term result for both group. So I recommend, so my next trial I will do for the next year, comparative study for dealing with this perforator in one place, and you can do also to comparing to have an excellent result for the recurrence between the foam therapy and the radio frequency. Okay, so you can see the best of which for the safety and the chief for this patient.
Thank you, Professor Ahab. Now, please we shift to Dr. Samih Al-Imam. He was discussing outcome of venoplasty with the stent deployment for chronic iliofemoral thrombosis. Any question for Dr. Ayman? Yes.
Thank you, sir. You have not mentioned how many cases were post-thrombotic and how many cases were non-occluded iliac vein segment in your work.
Yeah, actually this is a part of the study, but the whole study we have mentioned that actually the main study is all over Azhar University. It's about 100 patients, about 37 May Turner, and the others post-thrombotic. But in this slide, we just concentrated and evaluated the post-thrombotic.
Post-thrombotic.
Yeah.
Yes, because if May Turner syndrome alone,
yeah, it was not involved in our study.
Difference.
Yes.
But you know what? May Turner syndrome is a diagnostic challenge in our country. In fact. It's forgotten.
Yeah, we should put this in our consideration, yeah.
Dr. Sameh, following venous stenting, what type of therapy you give and for how long?
Yeah, actually, it was a debate between us in the department.
You yourself, by yeah. yourself.
It's anticoagulant for only 6 months post-stenting.
Only anticoagulant.
Yeah.
What if you, لو سمحتوا لي comment, when we treat a patient, the economic burden of the patient must be taken in our consideration. Venous stenting is very expensive, and following this, some vascular surgeon prescribe 3 drugs to prevent post-operative thrombosis, warfarin or new oral anticoagulant, clopidogrel and aspirin. This regimen doesn't stand on scientific basis. Why? Because in comparing the arterial side, we give double antiplatelet therapy, not to prevent thrombosis, but as all of us know, antiplatelet plays a very strong role in atherogenesis. In venous side, antiplatelet doesn't play any role in this to prevent thrombosis. Thrombosis is due to, as Virkau said, venous stasis, hypercoagulable, and injury to endothelium. So please don't prescribe clopidogrel and take into consideration the economic burden of the patient, and thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this information. We were shouting more and more because we were talking about the red thrombus, not the white thrombus. So this is absolutely right. We are given to our patient only 1 anticoagulant for only 6 months.
Thank you, Sam. I have 2 questions, please. I have 2 questions. I will ask you about the access point. You go through all your cases through groin incision?
I have mentioned that we have went through the femoral, the groin, in only 12 patients, 14 patients. But 6 patients popliteal. We went for popliteal access.
Great, thank you. Yeah. And what type of stent?
We used Venovo stent and wall stent.
Great,
but we
thank
don't
you.
Have Zelvarina, by the way.
You know, Sam, the access by Raju and Peter Neglin is mid-thigh, neither groin nor popliteal in the chronic cases. And in our center at Ain Shams University, of about 30 cases, most cases were mid-thigh under duplex guidance, mid-thigh of the femoral vein, actually.
Yes, actually, we started this work about 4 years ago. The duplex guidance was not fully, spread, because Dr. Wasila Taha was more duty, right?
That's why. This was my question for you, Samah. Do you use the duplex to select the access?
Yes, of course. And by the way, the 20 patient, we have got our access from the first time. It's because of the duplex ultrasound. That's why this is the answer of the question for Professor Ahmed. We used the popliteal access with duplex guided. That's why we didn't miss it.
Yeah, thanks, Sam. But as Professor Ahmed said, going through groin, nowadays questionable.
Yeah.
Please, let's shift to Professor Wasila. She was discussing surveillance after venous stenting, venography, and duplex ultrasound. Questions for yes.
Thank you, Professor Wasila, for as always your nice presentation. But I have a question about the design of your study. You mentioned that it is a retrospective study.
So it's a retrospective study for prospective collective data. Since 2014 until December 2017, all the cases performed iliac vein stenting, we categorized it in three groups, either in the onset of the acute iliofemoral DVT with stenting, this is the first group, second group with chronic iliac vein occlusion, and the third one, non-thrombotic, non-occlusive. So we collect the data and we analyze it as we go for the follow-up according to our protocol.
Congratulations, Dr. Wasila, for this nice presentation. Asking, you do any another modality for comparing duplex with CTV or venogram to confirm the duplex accuracy and the specificity for these cases?
Yes, Dr. Hisham, it's a very interesting and very stimulating question. We don't have a large volume, but in very individual cases, we confront such answer of your question. The sensitivity of the duplex, in so many cases, they were not appreciated by venography, and they were very much appreciated by the duplex because the duplex has the objective criteria, as you know. We can measure the diameter, we can measure the velocity ratio, so we can say that it's a significant stenotic lesion. We have one case, it was confirmed also by the IVUS. And IVUS nowadays is the gold standard for iliac vein lesions. But it's an expensive tool, of course. And it was confirmed by the IVUS, but it wasn't appreciated by venography.
Okay. Now we shift to Dr. Mohamed Ismail. All of us have. but I'll get the privilege to ask first. Okay. Dr. Mohamed, he was talking about IVC, the enemy behind the gate. Dr. Rashad, please.
No, I like the IVC. All cases I have castor, the castor inside the IVC to make sure that to remove all the thrombus. but before I use two thrombolytic casters, bilateral popliteal vein axis, and each caster I put it inside the IVC to remove all the thrombus before I put the stent. I must make sure that I remove all the thrombus. I didn't do a stent over thrombus. Because there is an occlusion. I treat the cause. I don't know how it is acute or it is chronic. Yes. Because the availability of the side of the stent. I don't have large stent. I didn't stent the left side, I stent the IVC and a double barrel pattern. I put two stents inside the IVC, not inside the other side. The other side, if there is a lesion, I put a stent. If no lesion, I don't put a stent. The double barrel inside the IVC. Yes? Because the IVC is the cause. The patient has IVC occlusion. Yes, seven patients among 64 patients. Chronic or acute type of chronic, I don't know. I put the caster for 48 hours to lyse the thrombus. After that, we make angiogram. If there is an occlusion, the IVC, I can't leave it.